Thank you. The fifth and final candle of Advent represents our Savior King, Jesus Christ. This candle signifies the ultimate reason for our Christmas journey, the baby Jesus, God's only Son, the Savior of the world. Jesus is truly the reason for and the meaning of Christmas, and he is the source of all the gifts we've discovered on this Advent journey, hope, love, joy, and peace. Celebrate the birth of Jesus. The waiting is almost over. The Messiah is coming, and even as we celebrate his arrival in our world, our anticipation grows, and we continue to live with the longing and expectation for his second coming, when this work will be complete and all the earth will be restored. Yet even now, on the eve of Jesus' birth, we rejoice. Christ has come. He will come again.
Isaiah chapter 7, verses 10 through 14. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." And he said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Luke chapter 2, verses 21 through 35. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, "Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel." And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, "Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign to his opponents, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Before we move on, we want to do something that's, I know it's going to be hard for James because he doesn't like this kind of thing, but we really want to take an opportunity to thank James for his just incredible help this past year. It would have been a blessing if everything was normal. But he has stepped in this year in these strange environments and has gone over and above the call of duty for stepping in as a music minister. And we just want you to know, James, that we thank you, we appreciate you, we love you, we're grateful for your ministry among us. And we want you to just hear from us how much you bless us. And so Will's going to come, and he's got something from the personnel team that they want to share with you.
Well, good morning again.
Good morning.
The personnel team has been pretty busy over the last few months, I'd say. Raji, Seth, Tony, pretty busy. From Noah to, we're excited to have him earlier coming in the next few weeks to lead us in worship as a worship ministry intern, to David. The offer is still standing on the table. We have given him up to a certain time period, so still be praying about that for David as a pianist. But ultimately today we want to honor and recognize James. Come on up here. Let's embarrass you a little bit. Come on up.
You can't embarrass me. I taught high school.
That's true.
So we want to honor James just for your love, your service. I know you're a really busy man, and this is so wonderful to have this blessing, the music that you share with us. I'll read really quick that we wrote up something a little bit from the personnel team. James, we cannot measure your role in the ministry of Coggins Church this past year. You've given us so much of your advice, your time, many hours of work researching, talents and assisting us musically with your presentations, and leading our congregation in worship services. We give thanks to God for you and for your willingness to be so involved in this endeavor. Simply want to express your appreciation in this honorarium. God bless you as you continue in faithful service to Him so effectively. Blessings, Pastor Scott and the personnel team. And here we have presenting Terry. Thank you so much for this beautiful frame. One of your favorite hymns. That's why I texted you. So with a trumpet clef and an honorarium to you, James, for your dedication and service to the Lord, love your Coggins family. There you go. And a Visa gift card for $150. Don't spend it in one place, but if you do, we will judge you. So thank you so much.
This is not necessary. I told the personnel team and the pastor a long time ago I would be here anyway, so if I can do this, why not, help where I'm needed. But I am thankful and grateful that we're moving forward, and I'll always be here to help. But this one that's probably really biting us, my puppy, because I finally got an hour where he'll just lay down and go to sleep when I practice at home. Anyway, I appreciate the love of the church and the support, the kind words you all have given, but anything we do is for God's glory, and I don't want to shine light on me. I want it to be about Him. And it couldn't be, as I go back over here to sing, All Is Well, with all the turmoil that we've had this year, I think if anything this Christmas brings, a renewed sense of hope when we focus on Christ.
Amen.
Always. All is well.
This is sort of a footnote. but I'll say this, that's exactly what they will see the Antichrist as, a political savior. He will be the one who is able to fix these problems. And I don't know what your views of prophecy are, but if they're anywhere near premillennialism or something like that, then you've got to be thinking that in these days, things just seem to be lining up for a world government. Globalism is a thing. And it's a thing not just for a few people, but it is massive. It is itself global, and it is backed by powerful, powerful people and whole governments. There was a time not long before I was born where the thought of one person ruling the entire world seemed like nonsense. But that does not seem like such a far stretch anymore. And so I'm not going to go there. That's not our purpose this morning. But only to see that it is these misconceptions about the work and the purpose and the personhood of the Messiah, the Deliverer, that sends us off into these idolatrous and false directions. It's always incumbent on us to stay very close to the Scriptures and to see what God Himself says, to strive to understand the plan of God according to His Word as He unpacks it. And that's not always easy to do, I recognize. But it is called upon us to do it. Many people only saw the Messiah as a political deliverer, a political leader. And even in Jesus' time, even if we apply this idea, this misconception, to Jesus Himself, this was a problem. The people who even recognized Jesus as the Messiah, the one who fulfilled the prophecy, oftentimes confused what the Bible had to say. They only considered what I call the glory passages, the passages where He won and He would deliver Israel and become a military victor, these kinds of things. Even the disciples said, "Lord, who will sit on your right hand?" You see, they're still thinking, earthly kingdom, we're gonna whip Rome, and you're going to sit on the throne, and one of us is going to be the first guy on your right hand. Lord, can you just tell us which one of us is going to be so we can start getting prepared? You see, that's pride and arrogance, misunderstanding of the Scriptures, and of course, the Lord Jesus on and on began to define that purpose. He was never unclear about it at all. Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, this is what he says. He says, "The coming king of Zion, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." You see, that didn't fit the image, did it? Your king is coming to you, Zion, humbled upon a donkey, the colt, the foal. You see, they only heard what I said, the glory part. Your king is coming. Zion, he's coming. They didn't see the humble part. And this is the key. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. "When the wise men visited, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Judea, the day of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came, saying, 'Where is he who was born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled. All Jerusalem with him. Were they expecting the king? The wise men brought it to their attention. And of course, Herod became very afraid because he saw this king as a threat to his own rule. And to send all the chief priests, the scribes, and the people, bring those guys in here that know the Bible. We have a need to understand the Bible for a moment. You know, this is the world's view of things. So they bring in the scholars, and the scholars say, quote the scriptures. And then Herod proceeds to go and try to kill all the children up to 2 years old to try to take care of this problem. You see, why? Because Herod saw the Christ child as a threat to his earthly reign over Jerusalem. And yet, was Herod's throne in danger? Not really. Christ had not come to set up the earthly kingdom at that point. In fact, Jesus told his disciples in Matthew chapter 16, verses 20 through 28, he charged his disciples strongly that they tell no one that he is the Christ. And from that time, verse 21, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and to suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed on the third day. He would be raised again. In fact, Peter even pulled him aside, and the Bible says, rebuked him sharply and said, far be it from you, Lord. In other words, this talk of you going to Jerusalem and being killed, you've got to stop this. This is going to defeat the troops, Lord. And Jesus' response to him is, get behind me, Satan. For you mind the things that be of men, not the things that be of God. What was Christ saying? He was saying, Peter, you're worried about pride and elevation and all these things that Satan was worried about. You're not concerned about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God requires that the Son of God go to Jerusalem and suffer. But they misunderstood that, didn't they? Do you have misconceptions about Jesus? Do you see him through a narrow lens? The world is filled with people who do. There are those who, like the Jews 2,000 years ago, see him only as a political figure. These define Jesus Christ and his mission in terms that carry political implications, like revolution, a military conqueror, or a king. They have military or political agendas that they want to happen. And they conveniently press the person of Jesus into that mold to try to make Jesus affirm what it is they're trying to push off. But of course, Christ knows that the kingdoms of men are temporary. There are those that like to see Jesus through the lens of humanitarianism. These people emphasize his healing and moral teaching. The good that he did for his people. For these people, Jesus is the example for how we should feed the hungry and clothe the poor. Others see Jesus through philosophical eyes. To them, Jesus' teaching, like the Sermon on the Mount, is an example of profound thinking. Elevated philosophy. That if man would follow, civilization would be so much better. But is that who Jesus is? Was Jesus just a humanitarian? Did he just come here to feed and clothe and heal? Did he come here to overthrow Rome and be a political radical? Did he come to this world to be a profound thinker and to be numbered among those who think deeply about philosophical ideas that if man followed, things would be much better? Is that who Jesus is? No. He's the Son of God, sent to this earth with great humility to die for the sins of his people. Do you have misconceptions about Jesus? Do you let Jesus tell you who he is? Through his word? Or are you allowing the culture around you to tell you who Jesus is? Number two, they had ignored the scriptures that spoke of him as the suffering servant. Remember I said they focused on the glory passages, but they ignored these passages that were difficult to explain, that were uncomfortable, passages that weren't so glamorous, and that did not portray in their mind the Messiah in such a great light. Prophecies like from David, Psalm 22, verses 7 and 8. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord deliver him. Let him rescue him, for if he delights in him. Psalm 22, 16. For dogs, he says, encompass me. A company of evildoers have encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. Remember, that's Psalms. That's not the New Testament. Mark 15, verses 29 through 32, it says, and those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, aha, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross. So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him, one to another saying, he saved others, but he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe. Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. You see, this wasn't the image of the Christ that they wanted. This wasn't the message they wanted. They wanted victory. They wanted conquering. They wanted revenge. They wanted power. They wanted prosperity. They did not want to be cleansed of their sins and reconciled with God. They did not want to be holy or heavenly, only to be powerful. Isaiah said the same thing in Isaiah chapter 53. He spoke of the suffering servant. He says, who has believed our report? Who has heard of us? And to whom shall the arm of the Lord be revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we would look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised. He was rejected. Can I say it this way? Jesus was not popular. They didn't want him. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised. And we did not esteem him. This is the suffering servant. This is the suffering Christ. These are the passages that Israel so conveniently ignored. They are clearly about the Messiah, and they clearly speak of the Messiah not only reigning, but dying, suffering, being rejected. He was numbered, Luke says, with the transgressors, numbered with criminals. Zechariah says in his prophecy in chapter 13, away, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who stands next to me, declares the Lord of hosts. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will scatter, and I will turn my hand against the little ones. And Jesus says in John, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, for the little ones, you might say. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Inconvenient passages. Inconvenient stories. We talked about out here when we were caroling. How some have said, not in our church, but some we've heard say, you know, don't put the nativity near the cross. Celebrate the birth of Jesus. I get the sentiment. And I'm not trying to be hard. But you can't celebrate the birth of Christ without the cross looming behind it.
Amen.
If we try to celebrate it like that, it shows that we really don't understand why the Christ child came into this world. The Lord of glory left the glorious throne room of heaven, born to a peasant in a manger, in a feeding trough, in a barn. Why? Because that was what he was going to do. That whole scene was symbolic of the humiliation that the Lord of glory was taking upon himself. Why? For the sheep. For the little ones, Zechariah said, strike the shepherd down, and the flock will flee. What happened in the Garden of Gethsemane? They arrested Jesus, and what happened? The disciples fled. A direct fulfillment of that prophecy. As you celebrated this Christmas, was the cross present? Because beloved, you can't have Christmas without the cross. You can't have Easter without the cross. It was at the cross we were purchased. At the cross the judgment of God fell that was due us, was fell upon his own son. It was there, you know, he said, my Father, why have you forsaken me? Can I answer that question? For us. For our sins. And lastly, Jesus knew his mission from the beginning. There was never any question to Jesus. There was never any confusion about this for him. He never varied from his purpose. He said, the Son of Man came into this world to serve, not to be served. He accepted the cross, and that the cross came before the crown. He's the good shepherd, dying for his sheep in John chapter 10, verse 11. He's the great friend, dying for his friends in John chapter 15, verses 13 and 14. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Jesus said, you are my friends if you do what I command you. He is God's servant giving his life for the nation. Matthew chapter 20, verse 28. Even as the Son of Man came not to serve, to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. You see, this was Jesus' mission. For this cause came I into the world, he said. Father, he says, let this cup pass, but nevertheless, your will be done. He told the disciples, can you drink of the cup that I drink of? You see, Jesus knew. He knew from the beginning. He was going to Jerusalem to be a sacrifice. A holy sacrifice, the Lamb of God, to the Father for our sins. And of course, God accepted his offering. Now, we celebrate Christmas. Yes, it's glorious. It's magnanimous. It's incredible. The incarnation of the Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, becomes God and man. Born of the Virgin Mary, heralded by angels and shepherds and wise men, moved among us, John says, and we beheld his glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the Son of God. But that Son also went faithfully to Calvary. That Son was not just given gifts and heralded by angels, but he was also beaten by soldiers, cursed by people, rejected by religious leaders, and put to death by the Roman government. Was it just a tragedy? Was it just an injustice? No. For the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. There's no greater story. There's no greater Savior. The Son of God dying for us. Do you know him? Is this the Savior? Is this the Jesus you know? All the other ones are fakes and frauds. If our Jesus is a political Jesus, if he's just a humanitarian, if he's just a philosopher, then he will not get you past this world and never into the presence of God. Only the Son of God can reconcile us to God the Father.
That's right.
Make no mistake, be not deceived. Know the real Jesus. He died for you. He loved you. He came into this world for you. Let's pray.